Former congressman from the area, not mincing any words today in his response to two deadly shootings, one of them in El Paso, his home city, apparently fueled by white supremacist notions and hatred. I want to note the Anti-Defamation League now says that the shooting in El Paso on Saturday may be the third deadliest act of violence by a domestic extremist in the United States in more than 50 years. Our panel's back with me. Amanda Carpenter, you're new on the panel here. Your reaction to the horrific news out of El Paso and Dayton, Ohio?
Well, I guess I've been watching pretty carefully what Republicans have been saying, and I kind of come down here right now. If the only thing you can muster to offer are thoughts and prayers, then those thoughts should be very clear and unequivocal about condemning white terrorism. If the words radical Islamic terrorists can roll off your tongue when incidents happen that are motivated from that ideology, it should equally roll off your tongue when it happens in another case.
Why do you think it doesn't?
I don't know. I don't know. It's a refusal to acknowledge the problem before us. And if you cannot name the problem, you will never solve it. And so that's where I'm really hung up. Why can't we call it for what it is when we easily identify it and identify it in other cases?
I don't know why. Clearly, the person in El Paso was a white supremacist. I'm very happy to call it a white supremacist. Look, I don't know of any Republican who wouldn't say that what we saw in El Paso, given the manifesto and given its legitimacy and everything works out, is clearly an act of white supremacy and should be called that. And it's terrorism in its worst form.
With all due respect, you're not a current office holder, I think is what she's talking about.
Well, I don't think you're going to see any hesitancy from anybody going out there and saying
you see it already. The president won't even call it what it is.
He did issue a tweet condemning it, but he didn't call it white supremacist ideology. He didn't call it white nationalism.
And he should.
And when he thinks
when it gets confirmed, he should.
And when he thinks it's an act by a Muslim, if he thinks it is Islamic terrorism, he jumps out before any facts are known and calls it that. I'm not suggesting that he do that in this case as far as jumping out ahead of the facts, but we need more leaders in office who are willing to say it. You're saying that you any Republicans that won't condemn it. Look at the office holders' tweets. Look at their, you know, what they're putting out. Very few are calling it what it is that are actual office holders.
I want to ask you a question because it is relevant to the conversation we're having right now, which is you heard Juliette Kayyem, former DHS official with the Obama administration, talking about, and I know I'm going to mess up the pronunciation of this, but I think it's stochastic terrorism, which is the idea that people are out there, leaders, and Juliette said President Trump, fueling the idea of hatred towards a specific group, in this case, immigrants. And then while there is no specific link between any of these leaders, whether it's InfoWars or whatever, saying these hateful things, then there is violence against these individuals. And the theory is that it is all part and parcel, even though the individual acts cannot be predicted, it is part and parcel of the same thing. You used to be an FBI official.
Yeah.
Do you agree with that theory?
Let's be clear. There's a difference between a sociopath and the tone set by the President of the United States. Let me offer a terrorism perspective on this, but nobody's responsible for a sociopath killing children. They are responsible for tone. The same thing happened during the days of Al-Qaeda. Somebody sets a tone, that is Al-Qaeda, that says violence is valid. If you do a numbers game, 330 million Americans, somebody, a sociopath, is going to look at the current environment, the conversation about immigrants, for example, and say, well, that validates the hatred I have. There is a separation between a tone set by a leader and the acts of a sociopath. Nonetheless, the leadership is responsible for tone. Do not give anybody validation for violence by suggesting that immigrants are bad. So disconnect, sure, in terms of responsibility for an individual act, but political leaders are responsible for tone. Last comment, President Bush, after 9/11, I thought his tone was right on. Careful, guys, this is not about Islam. This is about going after people who are responsible for murdering almost 3,000 innocent Americans. He was really good.
See, and what's interesting about this theory is that, you know, you hear conservatives all the time, rightly so, in my opinion, talk about the tone set by people in the Arab world, Palestinian leaders talking about, and the way they talk about Israelis, justifying in the same way you're doing, no direct link necessarily between what the leader says and a violence against some poor Israeli girl in a pizzeria, but the idea that you're validating this hatred.
Yep.
Yes.
And yet people don't, I mean, you can't compare the ideology of Hamas with anything else, but at the same time, if to either tone matters or it doesn't.
No leader in America, I don't care whether you're mayor, dog catcher, president of the United States, no one who wants to do violence in this country should think that they have a friend in higher office. That just needs to stop. But when you look at these mass shootings, been on the rise since 2012, to me, the big thing that has changed is the internet. And so clearly people are being radicalized online by the internet. And maybe the president's messages are filtering down. We don't know what, but certainly we have it in our capacity to do a task force or something to start figuring this out, because something is very wrong here and it needs to be looked at in a smart, responsible, nonpartisan way.
Number one, the president condemned violence this morning unequivocally. He has consistently condemned violence. So the idea the president hasn't been clear, when you compare that to Hamas and to Palestinian Authority, which rewards the families of terrorists who actually killed them.
I said there's no comparison.
There's a fundamental difference.
I said there's no comparison, but the question
is... There is no comparison. And I think you shouldn't have brought that comparison up, because
either tone matters or it doesn't.
Condone violence.
But either tone matters or it doesn't.
Tone does matter, but you can't separate the fact the president has been very clear. Violence is unacceptable in any form.
Just one point on that.
I don't know if we have the clip ready. But 3 months ago, the president was in the panhandle of Florida, and he was talking about the threat of migrants coming over the border. And somebody yelled, "Kill them." And he chuckled, and the audience chuckled, and the president said, "Only in the panhandle can you get away with that. Only in the panhandle." So I appreciate that there are individual tweets and statements that the president has said condemning violence. But the idea that he has consistently done so is not true.
Absolutely. Yeah,
well, I think he was...
Shoot them. I'm sorry. They said shoot them, not kill them. Shoot them.
He should have condemned that. And look, the idea that the president is somehow or another responsible or promoting violence is over the top.
No, but he's responsible for his tone, though.
He is. I agree with Phil that he is responsible for his tone. His tone has been curious to horrible at times, and he needs to understand that people can twist that tone for malicious purposes.
He promotes violence all the time. When he suggests that, you know, send her home, send her back. If you are at the rallies and you're a reporter and you are being physically threatened, that is a tone that's being set. When, you know, you can't ignore the fact that with a wink and a nod, he sends official statements that says violence is bad. And then everything he does when he's off script is, you know, I'll, you know, pay for the legal bills of the person who punches someone at a rally. You know, he has a tone that's rough and gruff and aggressive all the time.
30 seconds.
Yeah, I would just make a point. Even if you don't agree that President Trump has a role in inciting the violence, I want to ask, what is he doing to make anyone feel safe? We're afraid to go to the movies. We're afraid to go to the store. We're afraid to go to church. Where is the safe place in America right now from gun violence?
And that predated Trump, but a lot of people.